Hello everyone, our topic is metabolism and bioenergetics, that is from the subject introduction to biochemistry unit 4. What is the metabolic concept? What is metabolism? It is a sum of all chemical transformation taking place in the cell or an organism occurs through a series of enzyme catalyzed reaction that constitute the metabolic pathways. Each of the consecutive steps in metabolic pathways bring about a specific small chemical changes, usually the removal or transfer or addition of a particular atom or the functional groups. The precursor is converted to the product through a series of metabolic intermediates known as the metabolites. The term intermediate metabolism is often applied to the combined activities of all the metabolic pathways that interconverts the precursors, metabolites and products of the low molecular weight. What is catabolism? Catabolism is the degradative phase of metabolism in which organic nutrient molecules, that is carbohydrates, fats, proteins, are converted into smaller molecules, such as for carbohydrates it is converted into glucose molecules, or proteins into amines or lactic acid, CO2, etc. Catabolic pathways release energy, some of which is conserved in form of ATP, and reduced electron carriers, that is NADH, NADPH and FADH2, and the rest is lost as heat. In anabolism, also called biosynthesis, small simple precursors are built up into large and more complex molecules including lipids, polysaccharides, proteins and nucleic acids. What are anabolic reactions? They require an input of energy, generally in form of phosphoryl group transferase, that is ATP, and the reducing power like NAD, NADH, NADPH and FADH2. Some metabolic pathways are linear and some are branched, yielding multiple useful end products from the single precursors for converting several starting materials into a single product. In general, catabolic pathways are convergent, while as anabolic pathways are divergent. Some pathways are cyclic, that is one starting component of the pathway is regenerated after a series of reaction that converts another starting component into a product. As you can see, this is anabolism, that is from smaller molecules, that is amino acids, sugars, larger molecules, cell macromolecules are formed, while in catabolism from the larger macromolecules the smaller micromolecules are formed. The types of non-linear metabolic pathways are converging and diverging. Converging means from many of the products a single product is formed, that is from glycogen, starch, glucose, sucrose and etc. A single molecule, that is acetyl-CoA, can be formed. While the diverging anabolic pathway is that from that single molecule many other different molecules can also be formed, and this is the cyclic pathway, that is from one substance the whole reaction is occurring and then the same substance is formed again. Now bioenergetics. Bioenergetics, what is bioenergetics? It is a life is an energy intensive process. It takes energy to operate muscles, extract waste, make new cells, heal wounds and even to think. Bioenergetics is a discipline within biochemistry dedicated to the study of energy flow within the living systems. Why do we study bioenergetics? The understanding of metabolism provides the direction to better understand how skeletal muscles, that is present in our body, can generate the energy that we need and how and why the body responds to the exercise the way it does. The study of the metabolism is aided by studying these bioenergetics. The law of bioenergetics provides the rule upon which the metabolism functions. Thermodynamics, as we know, that it is the study of energy transformation that occurs in the collection of matter. There are two laws, that is the first law of thermodynamics and the second law of thermodynamics. First of all, we will see the first law of thermodynamics. What is the first law? Energy cannot be created or be destroyed, but it can only be converted from one form to the other. This is the first law of thermodynamics. This means that the amount of energy in the whole universe is constant. What can we learn from the first law of bioenergetics? The main form of energy within the body are the heat, light, mechanical, chemical, free energy, entropy, etc. Entropy is a form of energy that can be reused in the chemical reaction and is defined synonymously with the increased randomness or disorder. Free energy is referred to as Gibbs free energy. and is abbreviated as G. Typically, during energy transfers, there is a change in the energy forms, which is indicated by the symbol delta. Thus, a change in the Gibbs free energy is expressed as delta G. The main forms, the second law helps in resolving the problem. Mainly, the events that result in the net increase in disorder will occur spontaneously. The second law of thermodynamics. What is the second law? All energy transformations are inefficient because every reaction results in an increase in the entropy and the loss of the usable energy as heat. What is entropy? The amount of disorder in a system is known as entropy. The second law of thermodynamics, which can be stated in several forms, say that the universe always tends to increase the disorder. In all natural processes, the entropy of the universe always increases. Living organism consists of a collection of molecules much more high organized than the surrounding materials from which they are constructed, and the organism maintain and produce order seemingly oblivious to the second law of thermodynamics. But the living organism do not violate the second law, they operate strictly within it. Lesson that I learned from the second law of bioenergetics: all reactions proceed in the direction of increasing the entropy and the release of the free energy. The more negative the delta G, the greater the release of the free energy during the chemical reaction. Chemical reactions that have a negative delta G are termed as exergonic reactions. By convention, reactions that require free energy input to proceed are termed as endergonic reactions. But there are no such reactions in the human body. The free energy do not use to do work is expressed as heat. Reactions that have no net change in the substrate or the product are termed as the equilibrium reactions and have no change in the free energy. All reactions are potentially reversible. Reversible means from the product substrates can be formed. The directionality and the amount of free energy release of a chemical reaction can be modified by altering the substrate and product concentration. Increasing products may reverse the direction of the reaction. Increasing substrate may make the delta G more negative. Of course, if the reaction is reversed, what were the products are now are substrates and vice versa. The second law of entropy is that the disorder is always increasing. Now, what is mitochondria? Mitochondria is the organelle of the cell. It is known as the powerhouse of the cell. This is the structure of the mitochondria. State standard. Students now know that both in plants and animals, mitochondria make the chemical bond energy available to the cells by complementing the breakdown of glucose to carbon dioxide, that is CO2. So what does mitochondria do? They have complex infolded inner membrane that is known as the cristae, increasing their surface area. This is known as the cristae. The infoldings are known as the cristae of the mitochondria. They have fluid filled interior, that is the matrix, and they act like a combustion chamber in an engine, a safe place to burn the fuel with the oxygen. Glycolysis. What is glycolysis? It is simply known as the breakdown of the glucose molecule or any other sugar. It requires an activation energy, occurs in the cytoplasm. This is the structure of the amylose, that is a polymer that is made up of many glucose molecules. Polymers of glucose like starch are first broken down into individual sugars through hydrolysis. Means the whole polymer of the carbohydrate are broken down into simple sugar, that is the glucose molecule or the galactose molecule, etc. This is the simple glucose molecule. The single sugar produced contain the stored energy in their chemical bonds, but they are still too big to pass through the mitochondrial membrane. They are very big, so they need to be broken down again. This is the glycolysis of steps of reaction. Glucose is converted to glucose 6-phosphate. Hexose kinase is the enzyme used, and in there ATP is converted into ADP. From glucose 6-phosphate, fructose 6-phosphate is formed. Phosphoglucoisomerase is used. From fructose 6-phosphate, fructose 1,6-bisphosphate is formed. ATP is converted to ADP again. Phosphofructose kinase is the enzyme that is used. Then fructose 1,6-bisphosphate is converted into GLAP and DHAP. DHAP is again converted back into GLAP by the enzyme triose phosphate isomerase. GLAP is then converted to 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate. Here 2-NADH is converted into 2-NADH. GLAP hydrogenase is the enzyme used, and 1,3-bisphosphate glycerate is converted to 3-phosphoglycerate in the presence of the enzyme phosphoglycerate kinase. 2-ADP is converted to ATP. 3-phosphoglycerate is converted to 2-phosphoglycerate in the presence of the enzyme phosphoglycerate mutase. 2-phosphoglycerate is converted to phosphoenol pyruvate within the presence of enolase, and phosphoenol pyruvate is converted to pyruvate in presence of pyruvate kinase. Here also 2-ATP is converted to 2-ADP is converted to 2-ATP. This is the animation of the glycolysis. Glycose means sweet and lysis means splitting, anaerobic breakdown of the glucose. Here the ATP attacks and then it is formed glucose 6-phosphate, then fructose 6-phosphate is formed, and then one more ATP is attached, so fructose 1,6-bisphosphate is formed, 2-phosphate bonds you can see, and then they both are broken into GLAP and DHAP, and then they are converted to 3-phosphoglycerate, NADH is added, and 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate is formed. And then 2 molecules of 3-phosphoglycerate, then 2 molecules of 2-phosphoglycerate, then 2 molecules of phosphoenol pyruvate, and at last 2 pyruvate molecules can be formed. ATP provides the initial activation energy. The 6-carbon sugar will be broken down into a series of steps that do not involve the presence of oxygen. This is the animation. So at last the pyruvate is formed. Pyruvate is the 3-carbon 3-hydrogen, 3-oxygen molecule. There will be a net gain of 2 ATP. The final products of glycolysis are 2-carbon molecules of pyruvate, that is the pyruvic acid. Pyruvate is small enough to be easily transported through the mitochondrial membrane, where a new series of chemical reaction might take place. Now we learn the Krebs cycle. We know from the glycolysis we got 2 pyruvic acid or pyruvate molecules that enters the Krebs cycle. So Krebs cycle, it takes place in the matrix of the mitochondria. The matrix means the soluble liquid structure in the mitochondria. It takes place how? The pyruvate is a 3-carbon compound. So the pyruvate is converted into acetyl-CoA. The coenzyme A is added over here. The pyruvate enters the matrix and a base product, that is the CO2, is released, and pyruvate is converted into acetyl-CoA. It begins by converting each of the 3-carbon pyruvate into a specific complex known as the acetyl-CoA. Now the Krebs cycle, it occurs in the matrix as we all know. So what happens? The pyruvic acid is converted into acetyl-CoA, and this acetyl-CoA is converted to citric acid. Then the citric acid is converted to isocitrate. Isocitrate is converted to ketoglutarate. A CO2 molecule is released, and NAD is converted to NADH. Ketoglutarate is then converted to succinyl-CoA. A CO2 is released, and NAD is converted to NADH. Then succinyl-CoA is converted to succinate. Here GTP is released, which is then converted back to ATP. Then succinate is converted to fumarate. Here FAD is converted to FADH2. Then fumarate is converted to malate, and then malate is again converted back to oxaloacetate, and NADA is converted to NADH. As the cycle proceeds, CO2 molecule is released, and as a result the 6-carbon that was formed in the citric acid is converted to 4-carbon. There is a net gain in the ATP, and an electron transport chain is charged. So what is an electron transport chain? It takes place in the cristae. What is the cristae? This layer, the inner membrane, the infolding of the mitochondria is known as the cristae. The membrane, plasma membrane present in the cristae of the mitochondria consists of a few enzyme complexes through which the electron transport chain occurs. So what happens? The NAD that was released in the TCA cycle, that is the Krebs cycle, it releases the electrons, and the electrons is transported from the enzyme complex 1 to coenzyme Q, then to enzyme complex 2, and then to cytochrome C, and then at last to enzyme complex 3. And what happens as the electron is transported? Protons are transferred from the inner membrane into the intermembrane space. So there is a proton gradient form. The intermembrane space is meant to be more positive. So what happens? The intermembrane space is charged to be positive, so they have a positive charge as in comparison to the matrix. This will draw the H plus, creating a high concentration which can be used in the proton pump. So the proton pumping occurs with the help of the enzyme ATP synthase, that is the enzyme complex 5. So what happens, the ATP continues to be made. What happens, the proton that was present in the intermembrane space, it is again brought back into the matrix by the ATPase synthase. And what happens, an inorganic ADP and PI combines together to form ATP, that is the adenine triphosphate, which is the cell currency. So what happens at last, the powers the enzyme ATP synthase, which is used to make ATP. ATP is adenine triphosphate, which is the currency of the cell. So let's calculate how much ATP is formed. From glycolysis in cytoplasm, no O2 is used, 4 ATP is formed. From Krebs cycle, no O2, 2 ATP is formed. From electron transport chain with O2, 32 ATP is formed. So the total there are 38 ATP formed, but 2 ATP is used as an activation energy process. So at last, from net yield, from one glucose we obtain 36 net ATP. Now mineral metabolism. A mineral is a naturally occurring substance that is solid and stable at room temperature, representable by all the chemical formula, usually abiogenic, and has an ordered atomic structure. It is different from a rock, which can be aggregate of the minerals or non-minerals and does not have a specific chemical composition. The exact definition of the mineral is under debate, especially with respect to the requirement a valid species be abiogenic, and to the lesser extent with regard to it having an ordered atomic structure. The study of the mineral is known as mineralogy. Functions of minerals are as follow. Some participate with the enzyme, means they act as a cofactor and helps the enzyme to help the reaction to occur properly. For example, magnesium, manganese, copper, zinc and potassium. Some have structural function, for example, calcium and phosphate in our bones and teeth, sulfur in keratin, and acid base and water balance, for example, sodium, potassium and chlorine, and nerve and muscle functions. And then unique functions like hemoglobin, the iron takes part in vitamin B12, cobalt, and in thyroxine, iodine takes part. Now classification, mainly the minerals are classified into two categories, that is the macro or the major minerals and the micro minerals. What are macro minerals? Sodium, potassium, magnesium, calcium, phosphorus, sulfur and chlorine are included in as the macro minerals. They are present in the body tissue at the concentration greater than 50 mg per kg, and the requirement of the body is usually greater than 100 mg per day. Microminerals means they are in the body, requires them relatively lesser. Manganese, iron, cobalt, chromium, molybdenum, copper, zinc, fluoride, iodine and selenium are included in microminerals. They are present in the body tissue at the concentration less than 50 mg per kg. The requirement of this is lesser than 100 mg per day. These are the table of few macro and trace elements and the amount that is needed in the body. Minerals in food, they are usually found in all food groups. More reliably, they are found in the animal products. Often the substance in food decreases absorption, bioavailability of the minerals. Oxalate found in spinach prevents the absorption of most calcium in spinach. Phytate forms the phosphorus in most plants and makes it poorly available. Now deficiency and excess. Usually most minerals have an optimum range, means they are required in a optimum range amount. Below the amount leads to the deficiency system, above the amount or the level leads to the toxicity symptom. Mineral content of the soil dictates the mineral status of the plants, that is the feeds. Many may take months to develop. Thank you.